Doing the right thing, and someone told me a long time ago, if you're on the ladder, no matter where you are on the ladder, you'll be near the stratosphere of Diane and colleagues, but no matter where you're on the ladder, reach down and pull somebody up one more step. Yeah? So in my little way, that's what I'm doing. Not for any religious reasons, just for personal satisfaction, that's what I'm doing. I came here in 93, actually 1969, as a little kid. And then back in 93, when I was going around the world for 6 months, and I said, and I noticed then that Sri Lankans have tremendous entrepreneurial spirit, entrepreneurial culture. But you know the best thing is they don't realize it, which is the advantage of the rest of the world, unfortunately. And I was in the UK at the time. That was a great advantage because most of you don't realize how good Sri Lankans are. And I said, when the war finished, as a businessman, I could not seriously commit to investing serious money in this country whilst it was at civil war. I said, when this war finishes, which it will one day, I will come back and I will start a business here. That was my pledge. The war finished May 2009, I think, and in January 2010, I moved my business from Bangalore in India, creating jobs for Indians, to come to Sri Lanka to create jobs for Sri Lanka. And I think we were one of the first foreign companies to come in under the board investment scheme that they allowed 100% common ownership of companies. Although I had family here, I didn't want to invest with family, I wanted to do it myself. I had total control, as most entrepreneurs will tell you, they like to have control. So that's a little bit about me, and forgive me if you don't understand the accent. Who's from overseas here, by the way? Who is not Sri Lankan? Just wave at me. Yep. Did they tell you you're coming to the land of sunshine? Then welcome. It does get sunny here sometimes. It's not always like this. But welcome, I go. So those are my four things. Club of Daniels International, which is a human capital consultancy business. Recently, business hubs and the EPFS community. And I used to say most entrepreneurs don't describe themselves as entrepreneurs. Other people do. Okay, and then everyone keeps saying you're an entrepreneur. So I said, okay, I'm a serial entrepreneur. I was talking in Jaffna recently, and someone said, so you make breakfast cereal, do you? I said, no, maybe it was just my accent. But I'm passionate about that. I own 10 companies, and we're just in the process of setting up 5 more businesses. So if you're an entrepreneur, I absolutely feel your pain. I understand the challenges you're going through. At 57 years old, I'm actually now starting 5 new businesses this year. Not investing in, actually starting myself. So I do understand what you're saying. My wife actually said to me the other day, have you been diagnosed with something terminal, Michael? Have you been given 1 year left to live? Because that's how you're behaving. And I said, no, I wake up in the morning, look out, look up at the sky, and I can see the sunshine. The sun, not normally, but normally not today. And I can't understand why most other people can't. And that's one of the things about entrepreneurs. If there is something, when human beings, we're just wired slightly different. And if I ask you in the room to describe to me what is an entrepreneur, who's going to try and give me a suggestion? What is an entrepreneur? We're here to discuss entrepreneurs. What is an entrepreneur? Who would be brave enough to talk to Michael? Yes, sir. Personal what? Sometimes. For an exponential gain. So he's in it for something for himself, normally. But he could be in it for something for himself, exponential gain. Yeah, the answer, yeah. But it could be monetary gain, something like that. Anyone else give me a suggestion for what is an entrepreneur? Experimental, innovative, yes.
The man who provides jobs for others.
Sorry?
The man who provides jobs for others.
Provides jobs for others? Could be. A lot of corporates of business do that, if you like. It's good to create jobs. Anybody else? Yeah, I like that one. Somebody who puts something together and makes something better? Some hands over there?
See an opportunity every moment.
See an opportunity every moment, yeah. I actually think in the shower. People do a lot of things in the shower. Let's not go there. I think a lot in the shower. I have lots of long showers. And I think, and I just cannot wait to get out and write something down. And say, oh my God, yes, that would work here. That would disrupt this market. That would work. Yeah? I describe an entrepreneur is somebody who sees a business opportunity or solution to a problem generally just before somebody else sees it, and then has the passion and the vision to execute that problem and that solution effectively. That's how I do it. Not a dictionary one you won't find anywhere on the web. It says, you know, the words according to Michael. Somebody who sees a solution to a problem generally just before somebody else does. I was up recently talking, I do a lot of talking to young entrepreneurs, and when I talk later, I want to remove that word from the Sri Lankan vocabulary, those two words, young entrepreneur. Yeah, I have a big problem with that, and I'll tell you why. Because I'm not young, is mainly the reason. And I don't believe you've got to be young to be an entrepreneur. You can be 55. Who's going to tell me the age of the guy who started KFC? Was he 48 years old? Something? 65, yeah. The McDonald's brothers who set up the McDonald's chains were in their 40s. Yeah, so if you're sitting here over the age of 25, which the majority of us are, maybe over 35, maybe over 45, you know, lose the word young entrepreneur. You can be an entrepreneur at any age at all, 57. If I actually worked for anyone else, I wouldn't be allowed to work in this country. What a ridiculous law you have here. It's really good. In England, make you work till you're 70. They want the tax. But here, I think that's exactly the age when you've got the experience and the drive and the energy to start businesses. And I would encourage you to start businesses. I will help you start businesses, as I'm sure many of my colleagues would, if you have that desire. But it's finding that solution to the problem. And when I spoke recently to somebody, I said, don't try and be too clever. There are people in the world inventing the cure for cancer. Yeah? Somebody hopefully one day will do it. There are people working on astrophysics that are trying to put a man on Mars. Don't try and do it. Find a simple solution to a problem. And then execute it. And execute it effectively, thoroughly, and quickly. It's the speed of execution sometimes that makes the difference. People say there's no such thing as a new idea, just a different way of doing it. Maybe not. I hear some great ideas. I hear some stupid ideas. I heard some person say, we're going to put the first Sri Lankan astronaut on the surface of the sun. I said, son, that's a stupid idea. We're Sri Lankan, we're not all stupid, you know. We're going at night. He never really said that. They were going in the day. But let me just go on. So entrepreneurs just find solutions. If you look at Airbnb, who knows Airbnb? Thank goodness, in Jaffna, 70% of the audience did not know what Airbnb was, which was scary. I hadn't even heard of the word. And it's a simple solution. They put air mattresses on floors, in apartments, at pop concerts, and rented them out. Made money. Uber is a very simple concept. I can't stand the company, I don't like their philosophy, but I believe I have a business named Jackie Price. Anyone here supporting Uber? Yeah, supporting somebody who's going to screw you a little. That's just my view. But they just connect users with taxi drivers, and they don't know what taxi in the world. Great idea. Booking.com, simple idea. Don't try and be too clever. Keep it simple. Yeah, keep it simple, stupid, you've heard that. That's what it is. So, quick introduction. Glover Daniels, we're a human capital consultancy. That's my link, it's human capital. So it's recruitment, training, marketing, anything to do with business solutions. So that's what I do in my day job. People forget I actually do have a day job. How many of you here are in my Facebook group, the EPFS community? Yeah, it's good, good, good. This is something I set up in July 15. It's not meant to be a foreign group, and I'm very, very quick to point that out. It was called Expats Furniture. We were selling foreigners' furniture. Expats Furniture, we were selling it, and just for a joke, I called it services. People said, Michael, I've got a washing machine to sell, I've got a couch to sell, I've got this to sell. I mean, do I look like a second-hand furniture man? Obviously I do, because lots and lots of people kept giving me their advantage. So it's now renamed the EPFS Community in good old Sri Lankan style. I set up Expats Furniture Services Sri Lanka. Somebody set up another group called Expats Furniture Sri Lanka, without the services. So we changed it to the EPFS Community. Somebody then set up another group called EPFS Community. And then there's another one, EPFS Community Concept 3, and a WhatsApp group, nothing to do with me. So local versions. They say imitation, the best form of flattery. Yeah, I can't play anything around. But we have 57,000 members now, probably one of the largest groups. It's a social entrepreneurism group. It donates about 500,000 rupees each month to charity. To date, we've given about 18 million rupees to charity, including to the Masabana Homes, the Savoy Trust, which is for teenage mums. We've been supporting them now for about 2.5 years with a monthly donation. animal charities, children's charities, elders' homes, where you pay for the medicine for people that can't afford it. So it's giving social media a respectable face, a respectable platform. Social media can be extremely powerful. The floods this year and last year both proved the effectiveness of the EPFS community platform. I have an email, which I'll maybe off frame one day, from the United Nations saying, Mike, can we use the EPFS community as our platform for emergency messages? Because you can reach 10 times more people on social media than the government can. Yeah, go for it, help yourself. So it's very much a charity. Not one rupee, and you have my word on that, is taken in admin. It is all given to charity, every single one, 25 of them. That's our Facebook. If you're not in it already, you can join. Look for the three-finger logo. It avoids the copycat groups. But you'll see ours is significantly bigger than theirs. And that's what we do. We support a lot of charities, children's charities, animals, disabled children, handicapped adults, laborious, kids with special needs. Mighty Steps is a great one. They're teaching good citizenship to underprivileged kids on the streets through dance. So if you want to come dance, you like dancing, you better be at good school, otherwise you're missing your dance. That's stupid. A lot of animal charities. I'm a big animal lover. As the lady said in the introduction, we've done three fairs recently, which was giving home entrepreneurs the advantage to actually starting their own business. So we had 105 home entrepreneurs at the last fair. We had 39 people on the waiting list that we couldn't help. We are looking for a bigger venue, if anyone's got a big venue that they want to give to us. Just 3,000 rupees a table, but it allowed people then. People came up and said, Mike, this is the very first time I've stepped out of home and I've sold my product instead of my family and friends. You have given me my respect back. Which felt good, yeah? Some people are paying their own school fees for the first time in their life through selling jam or achari or cakes or making dresses. That's what entrepreneurism is about. It's not about running big companies. It's about just doing something and stepping out of your comfort zone and doing something. We have developed three new divisions, the Home Shopping, which is an online platform, a new Travel and Leisure Club to support people in the hospitality sector here, 12 months of the year. We have 6 months off season, which is crazy. And yet we have 56,000 people in our group that are consumers. So we're doing something there. And there's a lifestyle app, if you haven't got it yet, download it, it's Android, it's free. Gets you discounts all over the island. And there's an iOS version coming out in a couple of weeks' time. Anyway, that's just the introduction, that's what I do. Welcome to the future. I believe there has never, ever been a better time to be an entrepreneur in the world. And you know what? There has never been a better place to be an entrepreneur today than in Sri Lanka. And I absolutely genuinely mean that. There has never been a better place to be an entrepreneur in the world than in Sri Lanka. Let me explain what. This is the business hubs which I set up to give new entrepreneurs, not young entrepreneurs, new entrepreneurs an idea. I went all over the world, researched this, I went to the US, where surprisingly the average age of people in co-worker centers is 36 years old, not 26. There are people there that worked in industry for 8, 10 years, thought, you know what, I'm out of here. I'm an accountant, I'm going to set my own, I'm going to set my own advertising company. I know about social media, I'm going to do that. Yeah, so we set up a network of co-worker centers. I went to Disrupt Asia 16, and if you've been to it, fantastic conference organized by the government. And I went to see them afterwards, and I said, fantastic, guys. If I'd paid £50 to go and see that in London, I would not be asking for my money back. You executed that brilliantly. But hey, you know, when I walked around, I spoke to lots and lots of entrepreneurs, and they all said the same problem. We have no access to low-cost office space. We don't have, I thought that's easily fixed. We don't have access to startup capital. I know lots of high net worth individuals and angel investors that are desperate to invest in businesses, but they can't find you. We can fix that. Solution. Entrepreneurs find solutions to problems. There was a big problem. So I went to see the government. I said, great conference, guys, but this is your problem. What are you going to do about it? They said, no money, Michael. I said, no, don't believe that. I just bought 300 luxury limousines last year. And they went, no money. And I said, this is criminal. Don't use that word as a tip if you talk to the government, as I found out. Don't talk to that. So I went home and I said to my wife, this is criminal. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for Sri Lanka, not a generation. And yet people might call me crazy. I said, I'm going to do something about it. So I took 20 million out of my own pension fund and decided to go and do something for Sri Lanka. My finance manager told me the other day actually how much we invested, which is a bit more than that. I said, don't tell the wife, she thinks it's 20 million. But the fact is, most countries in the world, most developed countries, major economies in the world, are either in recession with a global financial crisis, or their economies are slowing down. Is the Excellency from India gone? Including India. Yeah? They are slowing. Still positive growth, but slowing. Australia, Russia, China, Brazil, Europe has Eurozones. The UK has Brexit. America? Any Americans here? You've got Donald Trump. You've got your own consequences. There is one quote ever that I use of Donald Trump. I did read his book, The Art of the Deal, when I was very, very young, starting off. I've not read it, it's an interesting book. But one of the quotes he says, you have to think anyway. So why not think big? He probably didn't think he was going to be president of the US, but you have to think anyway, so why not think big? Again, Sri Lanka, that is your problem. You think small. You think Jaffna is a big place. You think Colombo's a big place. You think Sri Lanka's a big place. Not really. Not when you put it on the global stage. But it can be. And I'll tell you how and why in a minute. Sri Lanka is not in recession. Fact. We are not in recession. Go to any five-star hotel this long weekend, or any of the hotels down south, they will be full. Not of locals spending money. Sorry, not of foreigners spending money, locals spending money. Am I right? You go to any restaurant, try and get a table at the Cinnamon Ground, they're full. Because of Sri Lankan spending money, we are not in recession. We are at the traffic lights with a green light in front of us. Most other developing economies developed economies have an amber or red light in front of them. And this is why I said the government, we have to go. We have to put the foot to the gas and we have to go, and we have to go quickly. It takes businesses typically 18 months to get through that danger zone, that maturity, in order to get past that place where they should survive, and that's a dangerous area. So if we are going to contribute to the growth of the GDP of this country, and the growth comes from the SME sector. The large corporates make significant contribution to the GDP. Yes, they do. The growth in any developed country will come from the SME sector and the entrepreneurs, the startups. People creating jobs, creating companies, paying taxes. That's where it comes from. So you've got to support that sector. And I said in 93, I said in 2010 when I arrived here, do you know what? You know what I think the best asset that Sri Lanka has is just not even being touched yet. It's not apparel or tea or hospitality even. It's the human capital. Sri Lankans are very bright people. There is a very, very good capability in English, written and spoken. They're very innovative. It's a very loyal workforce. When I was in Bangalore, the CVs, forgive me if you're Indian here, but the CVs were 3 months here, 6 months there, 12 months there. Every 6 months they came to see me and wanted to pay for this. I have a team in Sri Lanka that I got to the level of 6 months within 6 weeks of training. Okay, we knew a little bit more. But Sri Lankans learn very, very quick. And you don't realize how good you are. And that is the advantage of everyone else in the world. And you have to turn that into a strength. The human capital is this country's absolute untouched gold mine. And I'm not talking about sending maids overseas, the modern slave trade. I'm not talking about BPO, nothing wrong with BPO at all. I'm talking about people starting businesses. Yeah? Some of the brands that I've mentioned earlier. Booking.com. Who's heard of Booking.com? Put your hand up. Okay, keep it up if you can tell me where they're headquartered. Netherlands. Thank you, sir. Every other hand went down. Uber. Who's heard of Uber? Where were they headquartered? Where else in the US? What city? Don't know. Where's Amazon? US, what city?
Seattle.
Seattle, good. Why can none of those businesses be run from Colombo? Sri Lankans love that word, why not? Why not? I'm going to ask you, why not? Why can't a global leader, there are some fantastic global businesses in Sri Lanka, but with respect, I don't believe, somebody can correct me, we have a global leader along the lines of an Amazon, a Google, an Uber. And there is no physical reason why not. We have a great centralized location. We are 5.5 hours ahead of London, 5.5 hours behind Sydney, 2.5 hours ahead of Dubai, 2.5 behind Singapore, Hong Kong. It's a brilliant global business. That's why I'm here. Not because it's a beautiful tropical island, most of the time, but because it's a centralized location, perfect place. We have great technical skills. When I go to entrepreneur meetups, I'm fascinated by some of the technical skills, blown away by what I saw at Disrupt Asia 17. And this is cutting edge stuff, 3D printing, genome technology, some real clever, smart thinking. We're not short of brains. There is a reason now why India outsources its outsourcing to Sri Lanka, not just because it's cheaper, but because the brains are here. The app development world that's going on here, the AI, the VR that's happening, is phenomenal with Sri Lankan entrepreneurs. Phenomenal what's going on. We have great communication skills, both verbal as well as technical. Sri Lanka is the first country in the world to have 4G technology. We have fiber optic readily available, low cost, works most of the time, except in the store. We have 5G technology being tested in Sri Lanka. Not in the US or the UK, they're testing it here. So we have great communication and a highly skilled, intelligent workforce. I'll ask you again, why not? Why can't we develop global brands? And I'll tell you how it's going to happen, because it will, is when people start thinking that they can. When they can start realizing that we can be on the global place. When we go to any of these events in the US or Europe, we're not a little boy from Sri Lanka, yes sir, no sir. No, we're here, and boy, have you got something to watch out for. Because we're not playing, we have played a few legacy systems because of a 30-year war. We can move quickly and catch up very, very quickly. Sure, it's not going to be easy. You can be working in corporate life, you can be pushing a startup up the hill. This is where I see the problem. This is why I think, just the gospel according to Michael, unlike Diane, I didn't go to Harvard, and I'm actually quite pleased when I go and talk to master's programs on entrepreneurship, and I tell them I didn't actually stay for A-levels, okay? So I don't even have an A-level, but I think I can see one of the solutions to our problem. Would you like me to share that with you?
Yes, Michael.
Good. If 8 out of 10 businesses are failing in their first 18 months, it's often because we are backing school leavers and university graduates, which are highly needed. And I talk to a lot of young groups about it. Developing an entrepreneurial culture in the Sri Lanka is probably our first hurdle. When the parents stop saying to them, "Oh, very nice son, but go and get a proper job. Go and work for the government. Go and work for a bank or a corporate." Yeah, some of you are probably hearing that. My mother still says that to me. I run 10 companies, I'm 57 years old. Very nice, and I go, "When are you going to get a proper job?" But her proper job means I get a wage still and I work for somebody else. So we have to break that entrepreneurial culture, for sure. We have to put it on the agenda. The way we do that is to start in our heroes, which is what you mentioned, successful businesses. Some people think we need to develop a unicorn, which is a $1 billion business. I disagree. I don't give a damn if we do what we don't. I'd rather see 1,000 $10 million businesses competing on the world stage. That's the way I think we could invest. I'm not back one horse. You know, I play cards, I play poker. Let's spread the risk. Let's back 1,000 businesses. But this is the problem. They're going, I don't know if you can see the cartoon at the bottom. It says startup summit. People scale, they get to 18 months, 2 years. They then expand quite rapidly. And then they get to that 5-year point where they're ready to expand, and you have a group of 26-year-olds that most of you in this room would probably not seriously consider an offer to go and work for them as their MD or their CEO. Am I right? They're a 5-year-old startup run by 26, 28, 30-year-olds. And that's the problem. We're falling off the cliff. When we go to that growth stage to accelerate, the knowledge, the experience of existing business people that can actually contribute something are not in the picture. So I think two things. One is, you guys need to come out of that comfort zone. Fear of failure, so what? And actually contribute something to the ecosystem. Offer yourself as a mentor, offer yourself as a guide. There's plenty of us here in touch with entrepreneurs who would welcome your input, whether you're marketing, business, finance, tech, to help people. But also, we should be backing startups of existing business people, people that have got, you know, 5-10 years experience, that say, do you know what, I'm going to give it a go. Because then, when you get to this growth stage and people die, that shouldn't happen. Well, it won't happen. It shouldn't happen. Because you've got the experience to grow a business, you've worked in management of a business, you've also got to a point where you've scaled a business or grown a large business, and you can now attract the talent that you need to attract. There are some great places, EduLink, Monmouth University, that are developing entrepreneurial courses, which is great to see, fantastic. Business hubs, we're doing our little bit to try and help people. Moto Ventures, which is a startup venture in there. Moto University, they've got some great ideas coming out of that. There's quite a few corporates coming into work. Emma Slingshot, QSX, backing startups, opening up their markets to entrepreneurs. That's what's needed, is a joint effort. There's only one opening patch to support 600 tech startups. Fantastic to see. We're all in this together. Okay? We should be competing against the world. We always think Hubs is in the middle of it, and we help it, the thing goes around. But by working together against the rest of the world, we can become very, very smart. A bit conscious of time, and I know you're waiting for lunch. I'm not going to go too much. But this is the future. And if 8 out of 10 startups in the world fail in their first year, which is an internationally accepted fact, I'd probably guess that maybe 9 out of 10 in Sri Lanka fail. Which is quite sad. And I will go around the hubs every day. We have 4 hubs open, 2 in Kolpeti, 1 in Mount, 1 in Nugget. We're opening 4 more. The government has at last come to the table. Anyone from the government here? I'll insult anyone, I'm not particular. Okay. The government has now come to the table and said, we want to do something. They found this $3 billion, which is great. Oh, sorry, 3 billion rupees, which is dollars, to develop entrepreneurism. I said, good, get late with the party. I know you're Sri Lanka. But, okay, sit down, let's do it, because there is a lot to be done. So we're working with the government now, helping to start co-worker centres. They're not just in Colombo. You know, there is talent all over this island. Kandy, Gore, East Coast, North. That's where we need people. Keeping people in their areas, with their families, where the money is there. You don't need to be in Colombo if you're a social media expert. If you're a web designer in particular, stay there. You can do it. We'll find a way of connecting you. We're working on an app at the moment, Entrepreneur Buddy, which will connect you if you're in Batacloa with someone in Jaffna, with somebody in Gaul, and put you all together. Whether you're an investor, an investee, if you're looking for a collaborator, if you're looking for a supplier, a customer, we'll put you together. That's not difficult. That's easy for anyone to do. But I analyzed why are businesses failing? And I joked about people going to the sun. But I hear some great ideas, but then they fail. Why are they failing? That's what we should be asking ourselves. So I've done a bit of analysis. And often they're failing for reasons which could be solved if they were caught early enough. It'd be like a medical problem. If you go to the doctor early enough, you can get it stopped. So I've gone on record, and I'll sort of repeat it again here. Someone's going to shoot me down and say, I believe that 5 out of 10 businesses that run out of a business hub with our support will still be trading in 18 months' time. That's my aim. I'd like 10 out of 10, but that's not going to happen. 5 out of 10. Because you know why they're failing? Tech teams are starting developing great tech products, and they're brilliantly designed, but they have no go-to-market strategy. They don't know how to sell the product. So they fail. I see salespeople that are really good salespeople. I used to teach salespeople. Really capable salespeople that don't know the difference between turnover, profit, cash flow. I'm an A-level, but I know the difference between cash flow and P&L. And most of them don't. They literally don't know. When I sit down in a business hub and have a coffee with someone, and I say, what about your cash flow? Don't know. So you're making umbrellas, it's going to cost you 10 million rupees investment, for your factory, for your staff, for your electric, your materials, and you're going to make money selling them in the wet season, great, but you run out of money 4 weeks before the wet season. It doesn't come. It doesn't happen. You run out of business. But actually, that's something that's fixable. Yeah? You just need to get some financial guidance. It might be technical expertise. It might be business mentoring. But by offering that supportive system in an incubator, where we don't have any financial interest in them, we don't invest in our hubs businesses. We're there as a support mechanism for them. And making sure that, hey, you know what, we're going to stand around you, this very experienced team that you can't afford on your own. I have a finance manager who's got more qualifications than I can even spell, but they can't afford, but he's available to a service. I have a finance manager, sorry, a group marketing manager with 15 years experience, you can't afford, but he's there. Go and ask his advice. So by offering this supportive network in an incubator, I believe that we can make it happen. But we have to move quickly. We have to go full speed ahead. If we're having this conversation in 12 months' time, and if you're thinking of making the move and you haven't done the start of your business, you're probably going to miss the boat if you're in Sri Lanka. That's how quick it's going to be. Because the gap in the clouds will soon close. Everyone hopes that the GFC, global financial crisis, is going to pass. Some say we're in for another recession. Let's hope not. But that market, that opportunity, that once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for Sri Lanka, where we can go forward and others are stationary or slowly moving, will pass. And that will never, ever come back in my lifetime. I'm sure most of our lifetimes here. So that gap in the clouds will definitely close. That's actually a picture of Sri Lanka. I like it. Yeah, maybe I'm crazy with my view. Maybe I am. But like Stephen Jobs said, it's the crazy people in the world who think they can change the world. Sometimes go on and change it. And then what comes up now? It is the attitude. That's the attitude that controls your altitude. I get really fed up when I hear people say, forgive my Sinhala, I don't speak it. I speak one of the three languages of Sri Lanka fluently. That's English. But they say Matabaha. Matabaha. Did I say that right? Matabaha. And for foreigners, it means I can't do it. I can't do it. Back to sportsmen, you've heard that, Dan? I can't do it. I can't do it. I've heard that, oh, no, it's going to be too difficult. No. I'll stick with the government job and I'll be in that little hamster in the wheel going round and round. I can't do it. I go to dinner parties. This might relate to you. You sit around after dinner, uncles are there, bottle of Black Label's there. I'm going to do this, son. I'm going to do that. I'm going to change the world. And Monday morning, what do? They go back to their miserable job working for the government. Yeah, that's what they do. Because Matabaha, can't do it. Too risky. I want to give a new word to you. And I learned this the other day. Matapuluan. I can do it. Can we just put that on the agenda? Can we actually stop people saying Matabaha? Can we start saying hashtag Matapuluan? We can do it? Who will put that on their Facebook page? Yes, I'm an entrepreneur, Matapuluan. Horrible accent, whatever. We can do it. We can make a change. And the biggest obstacle in taking a global business or establishing a global business is in our head here. Not in the markets, not in the technology, not in our competitors. It's in our brains. We have to stop this I can't do it and change it to I can do it. Positive mental attitude. We can do it. Thank you very much for your attention. I believe networking is very important. If you want to join with me on LinkedIn, I have about 17,500 personal connections. I do also on Facebook, they're called Facebook Pause. But I am an open networker. I will link with you. If you're not in my Facebook group, join it. We have an entrepreneurs group of about 8,300 members. It's a virtual community, please join. We have lots of meetups and things happen.